We welcome this great opportunity to look at our continuity fear. Meet the new boss, same as the old boss. We've missed it again. The world has missed it again. It always misses it. The way to not miss it is to repent and say, I have a severe continuity problem. Then you realize, hey, I'm missing it because I have a severe continuity problem. It's causing me to miss it again. So you're aware that you're missing it. You see, I have this incredibly severe continuity problem, but that's the only problem I have. Without that, I would get it for sure. We all know the truth. All right, it's only a matter of acceptance, and the continuity fear gets in the way of that. Like I said in a previous video, imagine somebody who thought they were going to be greater than everybody else, and the way they did it, they said, I'm going to close my eyes. I'm going to go around with that with my eyes closed. They said, I can enjoy everything with my eyes closed. And they go on for a long time that way, and they start feeling like, you know, this is really, I hate this. This is terrible. This is ridiculous. I feel so ashamed, but I can't admit it. I can't admit it to everybody. So I'm going to claim that this, not only am I having a great time, but this is the ultimate. Got my eyes closed, this is the ultimate. All you guys are missing it, you know. And so they try to aggrandize the state of having their eyes shut. And they do that for so long, eventually they say they're really afraid to open their eyes. They try one time, maybe they see the light and they freak out. They say, what is that? I must be going crazy. Shut their eyes. Then they say, you know what? I don't even have any eyes to open. There's no such thing as eyes. So the whole thing is ridiculous talk. Won't even talk about it anymore. So you go into deep, 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 deep denial with the continuity fear. Deep, 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 deep denial. And unless you're aware of this continuity fear and embrace it, own it, own it, own it, own it, you're going to go right past the answer again and again and again and miss it and fumble it away and not even know you fumble it away and claim, hey, I've got it. You know, that's what the world loves to say. I've got it. Now we know. Now we know. All twisted, all distorted, all being run by our continuity fear. Whatever answer is given in this world, for sure, people will distort it and misinterpret it because of their continuity fear. It's happened over and over and over, and it keeps happening, it keeps happening, it keeps happening, it keeps happening. The way to put to halt that, to end it, is to admit I have a very severe continuity fear, extremely severe, but it's the only problem I have. I don't have any other problem. This is like a miracle. It's a miracle. And this is what the world needs. Until the world truly repents, and which is to admit they have a severe continuity problem, which means to admit that they have been going on the wrong path for so long. They've been trying to change reality for so long with great effort to change reality that they've developed this extreme continuity fear. Until we do that, we're lost. We're lost sheep. But remember, we're honoring ourselves by admitting that. We're honoring God, and God honors us through the vision of oneness. God honors us, saying, "What incredibly adventurous spirit you are to have embarked upon this madcap idea and pursued it with such incredible tenacity that you developed this incredibly severe continuity problem." So that's great. I mean, that just shows how intrepid and wonderful you are. But you still have this severe continuity problem. It has to be resolved. So this is the basis of the new teaching. The new way is to accept you have a continuity problem. The other ways have not worked, and they will continue to not work. You occasionally get a teacher that comes along and they'll teach, and everybody eventually, the misemphasis, the confusion, everything, and they think they've got it, and it spins off into all different directions, and nobody's even aware that they don't have it because they have a gigantically severe continuity problem. Everybody here has that, with the rare exceptions of those who have worked through it. Okay. So you have to keep an open mind. You have to keep clarifying. You cannot get too dogmatic. Okay, don't get too dogmatic. And yet at the same time, you have to apply yourself. And if it doesn't get you the goal you thought it would, say it's because of a severe continuity problem, not because the goal isn't there, not because you're incompetent, but because your continuity fear gets in the way. And so it's very important to realize this. Otherwise, we will allow our fear to tell us that we're pursuing an imaginary goal of vision of oneness. They'll say, that's an imaginary goal. It doesn't exist. That's why I can't get it, because it doesn't exist. Or I'm too incompetent to reach the goal. I'll never reach it because there's something wrong with me. I'm just too incompetent. I'm not smart enough. All this stuff. There's no such thing as anyone who's not smart enough. Or there's no such thing as anyone's incompetent. It's entirely due to the continuity fear. 100%. 100%. We are all spirit. How can spirit be incompetent? Not possible. But spirit could have a continuity fear, having pursued this objective of trying to change reality, which spirit has done. That results in a continuity problem, but it doesn't mean that spirit's incompetent or stupid or incapable or anything like that. In fact, just the opposite. Just the opposite. Spirit is absolutely competent, but has a severe continuity problem. This completely changes the playing field. The whole playing field has been changed now. And the prospects are way brighter than before. It's not some baffling path. It's not baffling anymore. And I'm suffering right now from a severe continuity fear crisis because I made so much progress. I'm having the backlash now of the continuity fear. It's been brutal, very difficult. But because I say, well, it's just the continuity fear, kick, dragging its heels. I say, okay. That's fine. That's just a testimony to, what tremendous efforts I went to try and change reality. So this is the price I'm paying. And so you stay patient, stay calm. You don't get too down on yourself. It's very difficult to not get down on yourself. When you feel like you're failing, I feel like I've completely failed because my mind is kind of confused. I'm just not able to be incisive, all this stuff. Continuity fear. A lot of dust has arisen, severe, heavy dreams that gave rise to, wow, there's a lot of fear trying to drag me back down here in this world. That's unacknowledged continuity fear, and people who don't acknowledge it, that's where the trouble is. They feel that you're attacking them. They feel that you're not doing what they want. What they want is to be protected from their continuity fear, which means for you to behave insanely, actually, and not speak truth here. And people think they have they figured out a way now to be happy, here, without dealing with their continuity fear. It's not possible. It's not possible. So God challenges us to remember our true nature. So we'll always be challenged in this world. We'll always be challenged. So it's better to embrace the challenge than to constantly fight against it. Embrace the challenge, and our challenge is to melt away and evaporate that continuity fear that we have, and to be humble and work at it every day. That's the challenge that we have here. And whatever the situation is, I'm the one who has to melt away my continuity fear. So whatever other people are doing, that's their problem. My problem is I have a severe continuity problem. That's it. And so you just keep working on it. It doesn't matter if others are or not or whatever they're doing. It doesn't matter. You have to repent and say, I have a severe continuity problem. Therefore, I must work on it today. I'm obligated. Now that I've recognized the severe problem, I'm obligated to work on it. It's an obligation, actually. And people who don't want to do that, they try to come through some clever demagoguery, of superiority or entitlement or whatever that kind of demagoguery, spiritual demagoguery they want to employ. There's a lot, oh, we're superior, we don't need to do this, we're more advanced, blah, 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 blah. It's just, continuity fear talking, cleverness. Jesus calls the continuity fear the ego, but I prefer the term the continuity fear. The ego gets all caught up in Freudian stuff and psychoanalysis and self and blah, 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 blah. Forget it. The continuity fear is much more descriptive. It's that's literally what it is, actually. We're afraid to open our eyes. We're afraid to even admit we have an eye, as it were, to open. We're afraid to admit we can even shift our attention. You see, we don't even want to admit we have attention. We've gone to such steps, no, I don't have any attention, therefore I can't shift my attention, and there's nothing to shift attention to. You know, what are you talking about? There's a world, there's bodies, there are people, that's it. And you know, we just go down that direction. But we must realize that we do have a severe problem. Not a little one. It's very severe. Very severe. Caused us to come up short. We settle for half measures. And it's... The path is tough. You have to get the discipline, the patience, the willingness to endure. It's an endurance sort of situation where you have to endure. So many people try to say, well, I'm better than you, therefore I made it, and you didn't, because you can't really say that I haven't, because I can always say, well, I'm better than you, and therefore my word is more reliable than yours. And they use all these games, they play all these games. That's not it. That's not repentance, that's not humility. I want to hear humility from people, from everyone. That is, I have a severe, severe problem, but there's many, many people in the world, especially those who are chasing entitlements, who will not do that. They won't do that. And they'll go into another cycle of delay is what they'll do. So Jesus said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall inherit the kingdom, right? That's right. Those who don't feel that they have any entitlements in this world, which I certainly feel that way. I don't. Never felt that entitlements. Therefore, you feel like you have to work really diligently, and nothing's going to be given to you from the world, and therefore you have to face what your problems really are. And that I found out it's just one problem. It's a continuity problem, but it's gigantic. And so I just have to work on it, because I'm not going to get any entitlements, that's for sure. But that's a good thing. It's a good thing, actually, to be seen as someone who's inferior. You know, not to be listened to. Spiritually inferior, doesn't have the kind of spiritual capability to listen properly and understand and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, like what we have in the world now is a positive thing if you can stand it, because it really says, wow, if I don't solve this problem, I got nothing in this world. No place, no position, nothing. If I don't solve this continuity problem, if it doesn't get resolved. So it's the proverbial thorn in the side, you know, thorn in the flesh. And Jesus said, "Poor, blessed are the poor in spirit," meaning those who feel that they don't have any entitlements at all. In this modern world, the entitlements are constantly shifting and changing. They always are in this world. And you know, you may have been up at some time, and now you may be on the bottom. It's always changing here. And of course, those who have entitlements are frantic to maintain them. Frantic to maintain them. At all costs, even if it means imprisoning everybody, if even means spying on everyone, even if it means, you know, doing whatever it takes to maintain their entitlements, but still, somehow it slips through their fingers. Nothing you can really rely upon. So if you're feeling, you know, down, like that's a good thing. Turn it into a positive. Say, wow, it's a good excuse to work on my continuity problem, because those who are frantically, you know, who are now shining in the world, like, you know, hey, here we're here, you know, our voice is on the ascendancy. We're the ones you're supposed to listen to, and you have to listen to us and all this. They're not working on any continuity problem. They're working on a power problem. They're working on an authority problem. They're working on an entitlement problem. They're working on anything but the continuity problem. But none of those problems exist. They're imaginary. They're actually the voice of the continuity problem, unacknowledged. When you acknowledge you have a severe continuity problem, those other problems evaporate. You know, they're like shadows. They're like shadows. The continuity problem casts all these shadows, and people are taking the shadows to be what the real problem is, and they're missing it entirely. There's been a lot of good teaching throughout history, actually. A lot of non-dual unity teachings of the one. There's only one being. All is universal being. But we still don't get it. See, the world doesn't get it. And instead we cling to whatever entitlements we think we can squeeze out of any sort of teaching in any given era, of saying, oh, this teaching indicates that we are superior, that we have a natural capacity to understand truth. Therefore, the others don't. We're superior. Therefore, we deserve to be a superior class. We deserve to rule over the inferior ones. We deserve all, on and on and on and on and on. Instead of saying, hey, you know what? This is a great teaching, and I have a very severe continuity problem. So, I have to be very humble, and I have to admit that I don't understand it. I have a great problem with it. I need to work to clarify and to evaporate this, and maybe a lifelong work. And so therefore I really don't have much to say about anything except that I have a severe continuity problem and I'm working on it, which is what we do in these videos. We're saying, look, we're working on this. We're evaporating it. We're working very hard on this. This has to be the attitude of everybody. There isn't any superior class, superior person. There's only one universal being. And more into the point also is that the crucial acceptance is that the light is equally responsive everywhere. Light is equally responsive everywhere. That's essential. Therefore, how could there be a superior type of person, someone who's more attuned to spiritual teaching, more attuned to spirituality, more attuned? It's not true. It simply can't possibly be true. If the light is equally responsive everywhere, where is there inequality of any type, actually? Doesn't exist. There's only the light being perfectly responsive. There's only perfection. There's just one perfection, and we're it. There's just one perfection, and we're it. To teach anything that suggests that there's some group that is superior to others, or some gender, some age, or some anything is totally wrong, because it suggests that light is not equally responsive. See? That it favors something over another. It's not true. There's no favoritism whatsoever as far as light goes. None. Zero. That's the essential understanding. It's the essential understanding. So we absolutely have to get away from all of the spiritual politics that's been swirling throughout the ages and devastates everyone. Hasn't worked, has it? Doesn't matter what side of the fence you're on, who you're promoting, or who you're pushing down, or say, it doesn't work. Never has worked. And the evidence is just saturated with the evidence that it doesn't work. Therefore, everyone simply says, I have a severe continuity problem. That's it. I have a severe continuity problem. That's the only problem I have. And you don't say, well, I'm better at solving the continuity problem than others because I'm superior or something. No, that's part of the continuity problem. That's part of it. So I say, no. I have a very severe continuity problem, which means I'm going to say all sorts of stuff to try and try to diminish it through posturing. Yeah, posturing is not going to diminish it. Actually sitting quietly and absorbing the immense great good news that there are no favorites in reality. There is no such thing as greater or lesser in reality. It doesn't exist. All is one. All is one solid block of universal being. There's only one. There's not many people. There's not a world inhabited by many people or many beings. There's only one being. There's no world. There's not many beings. There's just this one all-inclusive universal being, which is perfect. And we're it. We're it. And so absorbing this, absorbing it, absorbing it. shock of this, the shock of this, and still say I've got a severe continuity problem. No question, I still have it. And, you know, to be safe, we need to keep insisting that, you know, don't say, oh, has some breakthrough. I have no more continuity fear. It's not true. It's not true. Jesus tells us that there's absolutely nothing about this world that will ever remind us about reality in any way, really. Nothing. So those who are busy trying to make this world a better place, they have a severe continuity problem. Even though they think they're super spiritual. So I know I'm very enlightened, very spiritual. I know how to help the world. I know how to heal the world. I'm going to do all this healing and stuff. No, they have a gigantic continuity problem. And they're telling others that that's what they should be doing too, which is a way of defending against their continuity fear. They have not had practice, been humble enough to put in the time and the practice to, you know, melt it away and keep melting it away. We really need to shift our attention entirely off of this world. Because this is the world of illusions and mirages, of inequality. Unequal response of the light, which is simply not true. We need our attention to abide in the realm where it's obvious that the light is equally responsive. Because this world here is custom designed by light. That light, this realm, material, quote, material realm, is light pretending to not be light. Okay? So how can you get over the continuity fear when you continue to pay attention to light pretending to not be light? There's no way. There's really no way. We have to, as much as possible, we have to be able to shift our attention off of this world as much as possible. Off of bodies, off of form, off of people, off of things, off of all concepts and ideas related to bodies and persons and places, locations, things, all this stuff, specialness. And of course, we have a very hard time doing that, don't we? Which is why we keep failing. But the failure is because of I have a severe continuity problem. Not because I'm a failure. Not because the goal is wrong. Because I have a severe continuity fear. Problem is, you know, well, there's endless problems. Humility is the answer. Remain humble. Remain humble. Now, even if the continuity fear finally is evaporated and gone, there's an understanding that everybody else has a very severe one. So you remain humble and admonish them, you know, to understand that they have a severe continuity fear. You don't act like, hey, you know, I'm free, you know, you can be free too. Just come on, just do it. No, it doesn't work like that. Because then you get spiritual posturing. Getting our attention off the world is not an easy thing, and I certainly pray for some way to accomplish this. That includes getting your attention off of any form in this world. The practice should be to try and get your attention onto formless light. Okay, formless light, meaning light is diffuse, equally diffuse everywhere. You can have it appear to be whitish or goldenish or whatever. Just this equally diffused light that it doesn't change its diffusion in any way. No matter what's happening in this world, this light does not change its diffusion in any way. This is the vision of oneness. Certainly a way to practice towards it. The vision of oneness would include an awareness of one being that we all are, right? One being that we all are. In the practice, to shift your attention, try to shift it to the diffuse light. I only see the diffuse light. Now you'll see, feel the mind being pulled back down in the world to be judging of who has more and who has less, and how can I be on the winning side so I have more? More what? More light. More light. But light is equally responsive to all. So how can I have more responsiveness? I already have maximal light. The light is totally with me. The light is totally with everyone. It's impossible to say there's more light or less light anywhere. Light is completely diffuse. It is entirely diffuse. It's zero dimensional. It's perfectly responsive to all. It's perfectly responsive to the one being. All the all is universal being. So this vision of oneness, this vision of the one light, the formless light, reminds us that the world is a world of mirages and relativistic, dualistic conceptualization and misperception. It's a realm of misperception. Of course, perception is misperception. Perception is blindness, actually. But this vision of oneness is the one way that perception can be used to heal perception, ultimately drop perception. If light is everywhere equally, what do we need perception for? Perception is contrast. It's designed to see lesser and greater. Okay, lesser and greater. When we see something that's entirely diffuse and steady and everything, we say, "Whoa, I'm not perceiving. What's going on? What happened to my perception?" Well, we're perceiving with spiritual vision. Okay, spiritual vision. We're seeing this diffuseness. Our attention is different than our perception. So we can put our attention either on our sensory perception of things in this world, or we can put our attention on the light. So perception is blindness. It is misperception. It is a mirage. It's a hallucination, actually, of differences. Hallucination of differences where there aren't any. So this information now is easier. It's easier to go over this for me. I've been going through, pushing things so severely, I'm getting tremendous continuity backlash. But it's easier. It's easier. That's the idea. If you push yourself too strongly, you're going to have a lot of backlash. And that's why I say, look out. Don't push yourself with stimulants or drugs. You might make a ton of progress, but you're also going to have a ton of backlash. And the backlash will really punish you very severely. And you'll say, "Wow, I don't want to try that again. That's just not worth it." And you kind of backslide too much. Steadier progress is way better, because you don't backslide as much. I mean, there are times when I had coffee or some caffeinated drink or something, and my God, the progress I made was just incredible. I was just blown away by it. One time it was like I drank some vitamin water with caffeine, but they say it's natural caffeine or something. I said, like, "Oh, okay, so it's okay." And I just made so much progress. I said, "Wow, this is just incredible how clear and the progress I made." And then after that, I hit a dead spot, and the backlash, the continuity fear came, and it just bogged me down, for a week or more. It's horrible, horrible. So you don't want to be bogged down for even a day. Even a day. Your progress should be everyday progress. If you go 7 days in a row with every day strong progress, and you may backslide a little bit and say maybe you lose a little momentum, a day's worth of momentum, okay, but you've got 6 days of progress, and let's say you use stimulants and you get like 7 days of progress in 1 day, but then you spend, you know, 7 more days of being bogged down, not going anywhere, you kind of end up with zero, you know, right? So you're kind of spinning your wheels in that way. It's better not to try and force any sort of breakthrough. Let the breakthroughs come naturally as you maintain your patience and your humble mood of repentance. And they will certainly come. That's what I've been showing here on all these videos, that the insights, breakthroughs do come simply by conscious effort and acceptance and fitness that have a severe continuity problem. And it's not going to come easy. And there's resistance, and all that's to be expected. But, you know, many get lost. Many get lost. Some turn into teachers. They get so lost they turn into teachers when they're not really capable of actually being teachers. Here, I'm not a teacher. I'm sharing these experiences, showing, you know, what the path is like as I'm doing it. But I still have a severe continuity problem. Absolutely. Absolutely. Maybe a student teacher of some sort is possible. But not a teacher, absolutely not. Continuity fear is very frustrating because you might say, well, I already went over that 10 times. Why should I have any fear left? Well, it's probably because you're actually going way deeper than you realize. And you're really hitting on a deep, deep nerve, like drilling a nerve and say, ouch, you know, that I thought I got rid of that nerve. It's still there. Well, it went way deeper, actually. Really rooting out the confusion. So that's why there's a, you know, hidden resistance, and a lot of resistance now, a lot. And I think, well, I should have gotten rid of all that stuff already. No, it's very powerful, very strong. But it's going. It's like watching paint dry, or watching water evaporate, or watching an ice cube melt. You just have to put in the time. And of course, the world will always seem like it's passing you by. Always. That's the world's strategy. Hey, look at all the progress we're making. Of course, the world's gonna always frantically trying to change things around and make progress. So it can have something to point to other than the continuity fear, some excuse. Say, no, look what we're doing. This is innovative, this is great. No, continuity fear resides within everyone. Anyone that sees form, anyone's here with a body in the first place, sees form, perceives a world, severe continuity problem. And, you know, people are so interested in being seen as an entitlement role that they're not willing to admit to it, that they will be, you know, slick somehow. So I can smooth that over. I got the right touch to smooth that issue over. Whenever it arrives, I can smooth that over. And you get those people who are just able to, when they make mistakes, they can just smooth it over instead of admitting the mistake. Yeah, I've made a lot of mistakes, you know. Just thinking that something's going to happen and it didn't happen in the time frame I thought, you know, the mistakes. Uh, far as if you look through history, everybody, as far as prophesizing what's going to happen in the world, it seems like everybody has made mistakes, nothing but mistakes almost, right? It's pretty amazing how the Bible's full of mistakes. St. Paul, you know, all the apostles, and sure that the return of Jesus was in their lifetimes. They're just completely wrong, right? Just, so people just, we make mistakes when we try to figure out what's going to happen. But there have been times when I've been very accurate, too, in my life. Very accurate. And I used to, again, with my sleep problems, I didn't sleep very deeply at all. So I was aware of all my dreams, and when I got up, I was still aware of everything I had dreamt the night before, sort of in a half-sleep state. And I began to realize that everything I was dreaming would actually take place in a day or two, just the way I dreamt it. This went on for years and years. And I said, and stuff happened. I said, I this deja vu, I knew that was going to happen, because I just dreamt of it 2 nights ago. Exactly. Everything, the details. So I know that the future is definitely... You're able to see it in various things, but somehow it's not as locked in as we might think, because we all, of course, have free will. We can all decide to accept that the only problem we have is the continuity problem, and then that actually liberates us. So very liberating, and events are no longer necessary to defend against it, you see. So timetables can shift and change. Events that were intended may not happen. People are free to choose, you know, what they're experiencing is. The light's totally responsive, and they can decide, you know what, I think I'll just take a rain check on that. See, so there are intentions, but there's also, if there's enough collective decisions, that it can be very likely that something's going to happen, very likely. And trends can be seen to play out, be played out. But it's better to work on the continuity fear directly as much as possible. Realizing that the world is a very, very unstable dance of denial and misperception, fear, denial, confusion, agitation, conflict, desperate struggles for lying, self-deceit, power struggles of every type, insecurities, you know, that's what it is. That's what the world is. In terms of delusion, in terms of the belief, our belief system, this is what the world shows us. But actually, there is no world. And there are no people. There's only one universal I am, all is, universal being. I am, all is, universal being. Just a solid block of universal being, actually. With light being totally responsive. So that there are no individuals in the way we look at it, right? Because individual means that you have some special responsiveness from the light. You do all these horoscopes that people do, astrological charts, and say, well, this is, you know, this is the responsiveness of the light to this particular birth chart, and this is the way this personality is because the way the light responds, and blah, blah, all this kind of stuff, right? None of that is true. It all seems to be true because everybody's collectively buying into this silly notion, this vain imaginings. But there are no individuals, because light is perfectly, equally responsive to universal being. There is no such thing as more or less. No such thing as more or less. And of course, this world, what we call this world, is our to believe in more and less. It's our desire to have more. And in our desire to have more, we're hell-bent to prove that you can have less. More and less. Our name should be less more. Actually, all these roles are just one being, the roles of one being, trying to prove that there is such a situation as more and less. In other words, more responsiveness of the light and less responsiveness of the light, which is be changing reality. So you have this all this drama of the haves and the have-nots and the downtrodden and the privileged. But it's actually all these actors are like puppets, and there's one puppeteer trying to convince themselves that hey, you see, there is more and less. All this stuff is attempt to convince our attention or our awareness that our spirit, that there is more and less. This is all this evidence. It's kind of like a puppeteer with all these puppets carrying out this show and having the puppets talk and dress them certain ways and act certain ways, all designed to convince the puppeteer what the puppeteer wants to be convinced about. So how reliable is this evidence that the world gives? How reliable? It's completely unreliable, which is why we need to shift our attention off of the world, off of the world play. The world shows us nothing that we need to see, nothing that we need to see. Or here. What we need to see is the formless light. Now, do we see looking at the world, do we see the formless light? No, we see nothing but form everywhere. Of course, form outlined by space gives definition to all. You know, space is just the defining aspect of form, actually. The space that we see is the defining aspect of form. It's what defines form. It's not separate from form, it defines form. The true spaciousness, the pure spaciousness, is formless, entirely formless. So we need to look at this pure spaciousness. We need to look at the perfect, the formless light, to get used to solve the continuity problem. So we realize, wow, there isn't any such thing as more or less. I can accept that. Looking at this world, perceiving it, well, of course we're going to perceive more and less in every possible way. So remember that this space is what defines form. The space is what defines form. But this space defining form, space form, is abiding in pure spaciousness. Now, I've said before, space is what we need to see. Space instead of space form, space defining form. We have a space defining space. Space is defining space. That would be the formlessness. But we still can see it in a spacious way. Okay, so it's still perceptible as spaciousness. But space defining space, where we would feel this equal presence of the light, equal presence of the light. So this talk, of course, is going to kick up continuity fear. And so we realize, oh, you know, we're going to get, you know, punished for this. I look at that light. I look at it like, you know, you know you're going to get your knuckles wrapped, but you speak up anyway. I was that way always. When the authority would say, you can't do that, I'd do it anyway, and then, you know, absorb the punishment of it. But he ended up absorbing too much, you know, too much, for sure. Because I just wouldn't back down, and they say, hey, you know, okay, you can get your knuckles wrapped. Well, I'm going to say it anyway. You get your knuckles wrapped. So, of course, you know, in saying all this, there's a backlash. get your mouth washed out with soap, go to your room, don't come out until you've changed your mind and apologize and all the, you know, just whatever it is, punishment, be ostracized, you know, all this stuff. Space. So you can say, hey, I'm perceiving space. That's okay. This is space. We don't have to technically call it formlessness. That'll frighten us. We can say, this is space. I'm perceiving space. Instead of space form. Space delineating form. It's now space delineating space. Space delineating space. See? Perceiving space, delineating space. And the whole activity of this world is completely nuts because it's trying to delineate more and less through definitions, defining form, defining appearances, differences of appearances, as if that means that the light has different responsiveness. It's not true. So our attention shifting off of this world, the drama, the puppet show of this world, just a puppet show. The puppeteer is just manufacturing evidence that they want to hear. Just the puppeteer is talking to itself, just talking to itself, and thinking that the puppets are the ones talking. And the puppeteer has many arms, right? And carrying out this puppet show, all designed to convince the puppeteer that there's more and less. Ultimately, that spiritual ambition, an attempt to change reality, an attempt to say, my will's greater than God's. I was able to change God's will. So in order to try and do that, we play the role of this puppeteer. Actually, the light is playing the role of puppeteer and all these puppets and showing us. And the light is pretending to be convinced by the puppet show. Okay. But we are attention. We're not the puppeteer, we're not the puppet show. We're attention. Now, we think we shift off that, what the light is doing. The light will feel that we're not, no longer, they'll somehow break some covenant with the light or something. No. Because we ask the light to do this. And we can also ask the light, that light, we want to have the continuity problem solved. And light is responsive to that too. Light is infinitely flexible, infinitely plasticity. It can do infinite presentations all at once. No conflict in light. There's no conflict. So the light is putting on a light show. You know, pretending to be the puppeteer and the light show, convincing the puppeteer. And of course the light says that it's you. You know, the puppeteer claims that this is you. And see, and you're experiencing this. You're not. It's not you. It's not you. What we are is the attention watching this movie. We're not in the movie. The movie is being presented by the light. And the movie, and the light claims that the persona, the puppeteer, that the one that's getting all this evidence and being convinced by it, like, oh wow, I'm really convinced that that's our identity. It's not. It's not identity at all. It's just a play of light that we asked for. So this self that we think we have is not ourself. It's one that the light has imagining for us and claims to be ourself and claims that it's very important we identify with this self in order to get the evidence that we need, in order to be convinced. And of course the self is very convinced by the evidence. And so the light says, you see, you know, you are greater than God. You believe the evidence. The evidence is there and you believe it. What more could you want? But the one who's believing in the evidence is not us. But we think it is. We're too closely identified with it. We've been told that this is the way that we can experience what we want to experience. So we believe that our sensory self is our self. It has something to do with us. It doesn't have anything to do with us. Now that's a shock. And of course, the light will present whatever fake self is most compelling for us. So always it seems compelling, like, oh yeah, this is a compelling identification to make. So the realization, I am not the self, I am the attention that has been on the self. But I can shift it to the formless light now. Now the formless light is not presenting any evidence, so-called, but actually it is. It's presenting the evidence that light is equally responsive. So we're not missing out on evidence, we're finally admitting evidence to our attention that we've refused to admit. It's like a court case where we only accept one side's evidence and refuse to admit the evidence of the other side. Now the evidence of the other side is only one bit of evidence, so we tend to say, well, the other side has got millions of bits of evidence in them. It's only fair to let them introduce all this because it seems very important, where the side of the light is just one evidence. I can wait for that. Because it's one all-important bit of evidence which dismisses the case. It's totally conclusive, it dismisses the case. And so that's why we don't want to admit this evidence, because of the continuity fear. We say, I'm so used to getting all this evidence and sorting through and judging all this evidence, and then the case dismissed, what do I do? Case dismissed, what do I do? Wow. I'm going through a situation now. My cat is gone, dead and buried, and I don't know what to do, you know? The cat is like constantly interweaving itself into your day and attention and everything for 10 straight years. I look around, the cat's not there. Like right now, the cat would be here, the cat would be jumping up, the cat would be sleeping or purring, then it would be kind of irritating me, say, hey, maybe I want to come in, you know, always around, always interacting. Now there's no interaction at all, zero. It's like, wow, what do I do? Don't know what to do. So we're afraid to have the case dismissed, because all we've ever done is hear this evidence that is trying to build the case that, you know, that there is more and less, that our name is less more. Less more, or lessly more. And so if we listen to the other side introduce the evidence of the form, here's the formless light, case dismissed, then what? And we're not used to, now actually, we would sit in silence and sit in quiet gratitude and be the vision of oneness, which is absolutely what we really want. But the world is so much obsessed with collecting evidence, gathering evidence, judging evidence. That's what the world does. That's what everyone does. So we would no longer be interested in collecting judgments. The case has been dismissed. So of course we would seem different. And then you can help, you know, help others, encourage others to allow this evidence to be introduced. But our fear is that we would have nothing to do no way to spend our time. It's part of a continuity fear. Part of the continuity fear. Now, it's not really true, because we would be in this bliss. We'd be in bliss. We wouldn't feel bored or anything like that, actually. It's kind of like a mirage. We're dispelling the mirage. The mirage says, well, hey, what am I going to do? Well, the mirage is vanishing. There's no question of what a vanished mirage is going to do. Or you see, you know, we're just imagining that there's some need there on the part of the mirage. That's part of our continuity fear. There's no need there at all in the mirage. It's just our projected imagination. So Friday night and the 27th of June here. Faster you go, the tougher it gets. So if you're going fast, you're gonna feel, you know, tough resistance. Like the Marines in World War II and the Pacific Islands, you know, faced brutal resistance. And when the Emperor said, hey, war's over, then the resistance, gone. See what happened to resistance? Well, the Emperor says, okay, we've surrendered, war's over. Came out of the caves, you know, resistance is over. Those that got the message, those that didn't get the message, they kept fighting like crazy. I can speak to this in a family way. My dad flew in General MacArthur's honor guard into Tokyo, one of the pilots. And they didn't know what they were going to get on the ground, because the Japanese were, you know, put up just, you know, fanatical resistance throughout all the fight, island hopping, you know, in through all the islands, Guadalcanal, Iwo Jima, all these places. You know, just fight to the death, and it would not surrender. No way would they surrender. They'd fight to the death, you know. So that's their orders. Now the emperor told everyone, okay, welcome these people. I welcome them. You welcome them. But not knowing what the culture was like, you know, there was tremendous worry and concern that they would be set upon. And so my dad commandeered a jeep. Wasn't supposed to, but that's kind of our nature. You know, authority tells us to do something, we say, well, we'll take the consequences, we'll do it anyway. So he got in a jeep and drove off the Air Force base, basically went AWOL. because they weren't doing anything on the base, they were just stationed there as the stuff was happening on the USS Missouri and all the stuff was taking place. They drove through the streets of Tokyo in a jeep. And everybody welcomed them. Welcome, welcome, welcome. And it just, you know, blew his mind. He says, this is unbelievable. Just a day, you know, days before, we were engaged in this incredibly, ferocious, brutal conflict. And now they're treating us like a long-lost friend, you know, family. It's like, how is that possible? You see, how is that possible? It seems impossible. So that really gave him like an epiphany, you know, like saying, wow, there's something going on in this world that is more than we understand. How is that possible? What is it in us? Well, continuity fear. They trusted the emperor so much that before the emperor said, these people are like hideous aliens, they're here to come, you know. It's your God, obligation of God to destroy them. And then the emperor says, no, you know what? now I'm God. They thought Emperor's God. They said, I, God, decree that these people are very welcome, honored guests here in this country. And so they just said, okay, that's reality. You know, whatever God says is reality. And that's how they acted. There's no animosity. Drove all over Japan, no animosity. Never experienced animosity. Firebombing them day 4, no animosity, because God had told them, no animosity. These are our friends. See? So, the continuity fear can drop away. When we see the vision of oneness, the equal formlessness, equal formlessness of light, the equal presence of light, the equal responsivity of light. And we realize this is the truth. This is the truth. This is the truth God is telling us. God is telling us this is what's true. And the other isn't true, so to speak. Or, you know, the other was your dream. The other was your dream. The dream of more and less was your dream. Now you have peace. So your attitude, you can experience a shift in attitude. You can experience something that is like, wow, I expected one thing, I got another. You know, it's like, or instance, like if you go and your attention goes on the light, you say, wow, I expected all this hostility towards me because I'm dropping this more and less thing, and I thought God told me this more and less thing is my purpose. The light is telling me it's my purpose. No, we told the light that this is our purpose. The light doesn't get in arguments with us. So the light is not going, and when we tell the light this is our purpose now, the light will welcome us with this formless light, this the way the Japanese welcomed the Americans. Once the emperor said, hey, these are our friends now. So the light right now seems to be our terrible adversary, doesn't it? And presenting more or less like this in the false self. But when we ask the light, look, I want to solve my continuity problem with a vision of oneness, the light will, you know, present that to us. And with perfect responsiveness, there's no conflict there. We say, wow. The light's really not my enemy. Now, the light was pretending to be its own enemy, okay? It was never our enemy. It was pretending to be its own enemy because we wanted to believe we could change the functioning of light. So it pretended to be its own enemy, pretended to be dead, pretended to be in conflict with itself, pretended to be more and less, pretended that its responsiveness had changed, meaning the light really died to what it was, no longer what it was. So the light pretended to hate light. And that's what we're afraid of. Afraid of, wow, this is terrible. I got to fix this problem. We're saying, you know, we as spirit have to fix this problem. Light's gone crazy. It's fighting with itself. It doesn't like itself. It hates itself. It's in conflict with itself. No, we don't have to fix any of that. We nearly need to see light not in conflict with itself. And then to realize the light in conflict with itself was just a puppet show that light was putting on because we asked it to. Light really doesn't hate light. It's not in conflict. Light is not in conflict with itself. But we're certainly not going to see that looking at this world as our primary point of reference. Once we see that the formless light, equal present light, the equal presence of light as our primary reference, then we're able to see the world in the proper light. Say, oh, that's just light pretending to be in conflict, and we're not fooled by it at all. What we're doing is we're so worried about the light. Oh, the light is not functioning. It's crazy. You've got to fix it. How do I fix the light? How do we make the world a better place? How can we heal people? How can we do things? There's no need to heal anybody or do anything here. That's not the answer. Sickness is just light being in pretending to be in conflict with light. There's no person that's sick, actually. It's light pretending to be in contact with light, which has like this persona playing the role of the one who is experiencing this conflict, that it's the effects are showing up. Effects are showing up: sickness, disease, death, all this stuff has to show up somewhere, so that our attention can say, "Oh, light's really in conflict with light. It's died. Light's no longer what it used to be." So of course there has to be form, and the conflict has to show up in the form. Why spend your time trying to fix that form? Just take your attention and see the vision of oneness, and see the light's not in conflict with light. That's the way. Save yourself an impossible amount of terrible efforts to no avail. See, we ask the light to put on this puppet show. So trying to fix the puppet show. Wait a minute, someone's sick. Let me rush in and heal them. Wait a minute, what's that? Nothing's sick. Light is not sick. There's not matter. There's nothing here that's getting sick. This is the play of light. Play of light, pretending to be sick. We don't need to heal the light. We don't need to heal the light. Light's not sick. We only need to see light, that light is not in conflict with itself. So, this is like the third phase. The first phase was like Murray Baker Eddy Christian Science, which said that we needed to heal the light. Okay. If people were sick, we can use the light to heal them. Not truly appreciating the entirety that it's just, it's just a light. We told light to pretend to be in conflict with itself. It's not really in conflict with itself at all. So buying into the belief that we need to do something about it. Okay, at least the first stage is realizing that there was a sort of a unitive understanding, except that we thought we got to heal the light, heal something. Second stage. The second stage is to say, well, it's all unitive, it's all one, and yet what we need to do is healing. We need to heal this and heal this and make the world a wonderful, happy place. And yet it's all happy and it's all nice and it's all one. That's a second step, like Emma Curtis Hopkins, for instance, Emma Curtis, and New Thought. Okay, New Thought. There was Christian Science that felt this dualistic battle that we needed to fix. And then there's the second New Thought, which says, no, it's all one. But let's fix it anyway. And then there's this third phase here. It says, no, we don't have to do anything. All we need to do is see the light is not in conflict with itself. That's it. So that this is the third phase of this, you know, outpouring, which really Christian Science was based on Mary Baker's Eddie, and that, what's his name? Quimby. Phineas Quimby or something. She got it from him, a lot of it. A New Thought was Emma Curtis Hopkins, who was a student of Mary Baker Eddy, who had a more advanced unitive outlook, which she taught so many people. And New Thought movement came out of that. Unity, New Thought, and all this stuff came out of her, a lot of her students. A science of mind, divine life, and all these big movements that came from her teaching. And she taught more from her own, didn't write so many books, but it was more of like a teacher of giving this unitive teaching. Now this third phase is coming from A Course in Miracles. A lot of it's coming from A Course in Miracles, actually, which is the teaching of Jesus. And it's coming from the Holy Spirit clarifying this, and it's designed to save us time. Okay, we're not trying to go out and heal anybody. That's delusion. Okay, so Emma Curtis Hopkins still emphasized healing. Okay, it was still kind of like part of the Christian Science thing about we're church triumphant, we're going to go out and heal everybody of everything. That's still delusion. There is no sickness. There is no sickness. It doesn't exist. There's nothing to heal, actually. Except our desire to believe there is something to heal, which would be light in conflict with light. Light is not in conflict with light. Never has been. There's nothing to heal. We only have a continuity problem. The only thing that needs to be healed is a continuity problem, actually. That's it. And that's healed by the vision of oneness, of seeing this equal presence of the light, this formless equal presence of the light. Just shifting your attention to that. Because there isn't anything that needs to be healed, so why do we need our attention on the world? There's nothing wrong with the world. It's a play. It's a pretense by the light. So this is the third phase. It's beyond new thought, actually. It's the sort of the third phase of this getting to this point here. It really, now of course the Christian mystics throughout history were aware of the unitive oneness, and mystics from all different traditions, the ancient rishis and the Upanishads and the Gitas, etc., the seers of the East and the Mideast, and you know, the Judaic, you know, the traditions going back. That's always, you know, there's always been some of realizers realizing the unity of it all. But right now in our modern times, we sort of have this unfolding where we had Christian Science was very powerful, leap forward. Then we had Emma Curtis Hopkins and the New Thought movement that pushed it further, actually. And then that resulted in the ability to understand A Course in Miracles, at least to accept it in the world. But A Course in Miracles actually goes beyond the New Thought teaching, actually. And so I'm sharing and expressing what Holy Spirit has shown me about this. There's nothing wrong at all. Everything's perfect. Light is not in conflict with itself. This is just a picture show of light being in conflict with itself. It's not in conflict with itself. So what do we need to pay attention to any of this for? It's useless to us. It proves nothing. It proves absolutely nothing. So this is the rationale for shifting our attention off of this, that which proves nothing. Light's not gonna be angry. Light doesn't get angry. Light doesn't say, "Hey, you stop watching my show." It will say, "You're free to watch my show. You're free to shift your attention to the formless light. All is equal to me. All is good. All is good." So even bodies are made by the light, the action of the bodies, the life of the body, everything that's happening is a play of the light. It's a play of the light. We're not really doing it, so to speak. We think we're doing it. This is something that the sages have told us. We think we're the doer, we're not actually. It's the light, but we're being tricked. It's so convincing. It's so convincing that we are the doer. We are the liver of our life. We are the one who's engaged in doing all this stuff. It's actually the light is doing it, is a play of light. And we're the attention on this play. We are the attention, we're the experiencer. In a spiritual way. Now, of course, for those who really want to keep believing, their spiritual ambition can bear fruit, of course, the movie will be very intense for them. The light will present the movie very intensely, so they can identify, like, oh yeah, look at this terrible suffering, sickness, death, all this awful stuff. And for those who realize, no, I don't want to try to be greater than God anymore, then this is not necessary. This type of presentation by the light is not necessary anymore. So it's not the job of anybody to go out and heal others or cure anything. There's nothing to cure. But it sure looks that way, doesn't it? And of course, those who want this show, light show, and believe in it, of course they're going to try out and go out and cure stuff. They say, hey, there's inequality. Hey, there's sickness. Hey, I'm going to do something about that. That's all the play of the light. That's what they want to see. That's what they want to see. They want to see everybody trying to fix the problems. It's light that's doing all of this. It's light that's trying to fix the problems of light. And the fact is, there are no problems of light. So there's no end to it. As long as we desire to see this, light will keep pretending there's all these problems, and light will be desperately trying to fix all these problems. And we keep thinking that this is what we need to know. We need to pay attention to this. This is a lesson. We're learning something. This is our new life. The resolution, how we fix these problems, is what we know. You know what we're gonna know. We're gonna figure out the way. So our attention keeps being fixated on this. I mean, the sages realized this. Sri Sargadatta Maharaj said, what are you talking? This body has absolutely nothing to do with me. This life, say, what, life of the body has got nothing to do with me. Absolutely zero to do with me. It's totally irrelevant to what I am. Completely. See, realization. The one that is saying it has something to do with me is lying. But of course, we told the lie. It's pretending. It's a pretense. We told the lie to pretend. So. But it's just this elaborate ruse, you know, elaborate ruse. But those who see through it realize, ah, this never was me, never will be. This has nothing to do with me. It's just it's a joke. It's a pretense by the light. Now, a lot of the Vedic tradition says, well, we don't know why the light did that. Then they say, no, that's not true. That's not real repentance. We asked it to, because we wanted to be greater than God. Okay, this is the additional layer of what this third way we're talking about now, this third outpouring, is to know why all this is here. You know, the whole Advaita non-dual tradition, they shrug it off and say, well, it's a mystery. We have no idea why light decided to do that. You know? Well, you can't leave it at that, because then you can't really trust the light. Not really. Well, you know, maybe light will do it again and get a wild hair up its nose and say, hey, I need to do this again. No, we asked the light. Spirit asked the light. Said, Spirit said, light, I want to be greater than God. Show me the way. And so, you know, light pretended to die, be different than it is. And this conflict with itself shows that it's no longer what it is. And light says, hey, look, you changed the nature of light. You must be greater than God. Congratulations. And we say, okay, but how am I happy now? And light says, well, you got to fix these problems. So you then identify yourself as the doer and the fixer, but it's just light trying to fix its own problems which don't exist. So there's this additional layer to the ruse, what we need to see. That all this attempt to fix the problems, that's part of the ruse. That's light trying to fix the conflicts of light which don't exist. So there's nothing that needs to be done. Light doesn't have any problems. And neither do we. And neither do we, actually. Even though it seems we have intense problems, right? Like I'm reacting to the loss of the cat. Well, who's reacting? Light. The one that I think I am. That's light. A light cell. Pretending to be upset and because it lacks the light cat that was, you know, the light is pretending to make into form. It's all a play of light. Where we are our attention is what we are, our attention, the experiencer, but we're not we're not doing any of this. We don't need to fix anything. There's nothing. There's no problems. Life doesn't have any problems. It's all a funny joke, funny trick, or retention. But seeing that is a continuity fear. You may say, well, if that's true, how come we haven't seen that? Because there's a continuity fear there. It's like, oh, wow, what do I do? There's no problems to fix. There aren't any problems. Well. And we just luxuriate in the knowledge that there are no problems. Problems don't exist. So we luxuriate in that. No longer fooled, because we're no longer requesting to be fooled. I mean, the desire to be greater in God is a request to be fooled. That's all that it is. It's a request to be deceived. So when we drop that request to be deceived, desire to be deceived, then we'll no longer be deceived. It's impossible to have the request to be greater than God, the desire to be greater than God, and not be deceived. Impossible. That's the only way this can be played out, this whimsical idea, to be honored, to be played out, have to be deceived, have to be fooled, be tricked, be deceived. So light puts on this totally believable deception. It's totally believable, but not true, but not true. See, it's totally believable. So again, a continuity fear will say, wow, this is totally believable, but it's not true. Right. But see, reality doesn't need belief. Only being fooled needs belief. So belief arises, perception belief arises, when we request to be fooled. And since we're so used to this perception, the intermediate step of solving the continuity problem, we have perception of space. This formless light, equal presence, light not in conflict with itself, so no less and more, no battle, totally peaceful, totally calm, totally smooth light, presence of light, total serenity. So we're evaporating the continuity fear, because we know we have a severe continuity fear, which compels us to reason very carefully and clearly. There's a bug flying around here. It seems every night it seems to show up. It's great to be taping again. Even though I have this severe continuity problem, today's like one of the worst days of my life. If not the worst, my functionality was near zero today. It was horrible. I said, wow, I'm close to death, actually, as far as functionality concerns. Just atrocious. But yet, still able to, you know, focus in on this and just stay calm and realize this continuity fear is hitting me real hard. And if we just do some progress on this, it's going to lighten up to some extent. So hopefully, this will lighten up. Had some good dreams last night, really good dreams, about this third phase. It's a third phase we're in right now, actually, a third phase. Christian Science, New Thought, and now the third phase of Continuity Problem, Vision of Oneness. Continuity Problem, Vision of Oneness. Nothing needs to be done. Third phase, I need to do nothing. Nothing needs to be done. I'm free, nothing needs to be done. There is no problem. Third phase, there is no problem. There is no problem that needs to be fixed. Christian Science, what? New Thought and no thought. No thought. No thought's necessary. I don't need to follow any train of thought. That's light. Trains of thought are light pertaining to fixed its non-existent conflict. How do I fix this? Thinking. That's the light presenting that. Playing the role of a supposed us, which is not us. Light says, this is the new you. This is the one. No, it's not. It's just play of light. But of course, it's not possible to see through this unless we truly desire to you know, be drop our desire to be greater than God, because that compels us to be deceived. We can't have it both ways. We can't have the desire to be greater than God without being compelled to be deceived. It's not possible. We can't have our cake and eat it too. And speaking of that, I think I'll go have some cake, actually. I don't want this to go on, you know, too long. Oh, 2 hours actually is about the right amount of time for any real progress to take place. Because we need a cool down period, actually. This is heavy stuff. Heavy lifting. Sometimes I chat about like the problems of the world and stuff. It's just a way of cooling down. It sort of bring you back. Say, well, I can still think that, you know, I need to fix the world or something. That this is at least happening. I'm just sort of vague. So yeah, but doing the lighthearted, chatty way, like sort of breeze through it, like it's nothing really important. But it kind of, you know, it brings you out a little bit from where we were. Or you can just not say anything and just stick with the quiet, absolutely. Chat about the weather. We can go back over just synopsis of it. We said there's this additional step of the ruse of the light. There's this additional step. It's playing the role of us, or what we think is our identity. It's playing the role of someone being affected by the conflict. It's playing the role of the one trying to fix the conflict. It's playing the role of the peacemaker of the conflict. This just intensifies the belief that the conflict is real. You see, it's playing all these roles. Protagonist, the antagonist, and the one that is trying to bring peace to the situation. He's playing all three of those roles. None of them are true. They're all fake. It's all fake. It's all pretense. So we realize all three roles are pretense. Okay. The Christian scientist likes saying, basically, well, you know, one of the roles is true, the other is false. New Thought is saying, two of the roles are false, but the third role is true. We're saying all three roles are pretense. They're all false. That's the third way. The third step, the third phase. This is the third phase. The third phase is all three aspects of light. It's all light, pretense of the light. All this peacemaking, all this healing, all that's pretense also. That's a way of trying to make the conflict seem real. And consequential. Now, see, Mary Baker Eddy, the teaching was great, but the way that it rolled out was she felt very much in conflict with, intense conflict with the evil, you know, the bad stuff. Just a second. She had some sort of thing, was it miasmic? I don't know what, animal magnetism, malevolent animal magnetism, something like that. Okay, so she said, I'm out on a crusade. I'm going to heal all this. I'm going to use the light to heal all this. Okay, all right. New Thought was more like, no, it's all one. It's all one. It's all one. But we're going to use the light to heal whatever troubles the oneness has. You know, and we're saying no. It's even all the healing and the peace and all that. That's also a play of light. It's also a play of light, designed to mislead us, actually, to deceive us. Obviously, if we're trying to use the light to solve a non-existent problem of the light doesn't have any problem. All is light. How can we be using light to heal light? That's ridiculous. That's ridiculous. That's self-deception. That's deception. There's no problem with the light. Light is perfect. Light is flawless. And if everything is light, where can there be any problem at all? There isn't. But light can pretend to be in conflict with itself. Can't pretend to be injured by itself. Can't, but it's all pretense. It's an appearance only. And who is judging the appearance? Light itself. So this first witness, this first judge that's judging what's happening, that is also light telling us what it's seeing, you know. It's a false witness. Light says, oh, I'm seeing someone dying, I'm seeing someone be hurt, this is what's happening. That's light itself telling us that this is what's happening. It's not really happening. And this is what Jesus said, none of this is happening. What you think you see is happening isn't happening. It's a misperception. You're being told that this is what is happening. It's not actually happening. Now, this is a mind blower. This is the one I had trouble with. And of course, in miracles, this third step, okay, is a huge step. And Jesus tells us, hey, you think you're seeing death, all this stuff? Who's seeing the death? How do you know it's dying? Whose word are you taking for it? All this is happening? Is that, he said, it's not happening. It's an hallucination. It's not happening. Death is not happening. There isn't any. It's just like, whoa, wow, how do I wrap my mind around that? You know, wow. Well, we're doing it right now. We're doing it right now. And that's the chuckle. Eventually he says, we'll have a big chuckle. Because all this reporting, it's, imagine there's like this reporter who's reporting this war. Okay, this horrible war, and he's reporting it to us. And we're not seeing any of the wars, it's distant lands or something. And the reporter reports from the front. So all this stuff's happening, wow. And you know, we believe it. But what if the reporter's totally making all this up? None of it's happening. We're believing it's all happening, but none of it ever happened. That's why the sages say nothing ever happened, actually. Nothing ever happened. So this is very much a wow type of situation. It's just like, initially we just say, wow, this is an incredible situation. So, maybe light is just narrating a story to us. None of it's happening. None of it's actually happening. It's showing us a movie of all this, but it's not actually happening. Something like that, you know. So we're just beginning. We're untying this knot. This knot. This final knot. It's light that's telling us that the sickness, look at this sickness, look at this cancer, look at this death. What's dying? Light? It's all light. Light's telling us it died. Is that true? Light's telling us it was sick. Is that true? Maybe light's lying to us and nothing ever died. Nothing was ever sick. Nothing was ever born. Are we supposed to take the word of light, who supposedly is in conflict with itself, and now reporting on itself what's happening? Are we supposed to believe it when we told it to fool us? We told the light to fool us, essentially. We said, hey, we want to be greater than God. We're just telling the light to fool us. So we're taking it seriously. We're believing what it's telling us, insisting that this is happening. That there's some self there that's experiencing this. Is that true? Is there some self that's dying? So these forms, are there actual forms, and these forms are dying? Is that really true? Light tells us it is. It's true. It says the senses are seeing it. Look, the senses are saying, well, yeah, but other senses, isn't that light too? The light says the senses are seeing all this stuff. So this gets into really heavy territory, but it's fine, that's okay. We can at least, you know, touch upon it, look upon it, and say, okay, that's cool. Well, you know, interesting, worth considering. Maybe the deception of a light, it goes deeper than we realize, huh? Deeper than we realize. How could the light die? Dying implies more or less. I mean, is it meaningless? All these things are meaningless concepts to light, aren't they? Light is equally responsive to all, equally present everywhere. What do you mean dying? What is that? What is that? That's ridiculous. What kind of change? What changed? So the light was responsive, now it's not responsive. What is this? It doesn't add up. It doesn't add up. The story that light is telling us does not add up. So, very interesting. And our attention is listening to this, okay? Our attention is listening to this. And saying, light, maybe you really tricked me more than I know. Because light's telling us all this stuff's happening, so we're very attentive to it because it's like, you know, it's proof. It's our experiencing. We're greater than God. Maybe none of this ever happened. Maybe nothing ever died. Maybe all this evidence is completely bogus. Entirely bogus. Maybe there's only just a light. There's never been any person at all. There's never been a world, never a person, nothing. Just a pure light, actually. Yeah. That's what the sage is saying, isn't it? So, all they did was shift their attention, right? That's all they did. We can do that too. But I like that part about someone having more, and I like that part about someone getting healed, meaning proving that they had less at some point, right? I like that, you know, sickness getting better. I liked all this story, our attention saying that. But it was all just a story. It had nothing to do with us. Of course, light's pretending that we're believing it. And we're paying attention to it. There's another trick, you know, like the light is paying attention to all this, like it's super important, and it claims that's our attention. It's not. It's not our attention, it's light's attention. We're faking attention, you know, it's pretending to be paying attention to all this, and then making us think that we're the ones paying attention to it. Our attention is like saying, you know, hey, wait a minute, you know, there's something not right about all this. This doesn't seem right. And the light is pretending to be our attention and saying, yeah, I believe all of this stuff. I totally believe it. My attention is entirely here. And can't shift off of this. It's not key. That's not our attention. The attention that cannot shift off of this is not our attention. It's a fake attention. Light is faking our attention for us. See, that's part of the delusion. It's very interesting stuff, isn't it? I hope you enjoyed the video. I sure did. It's worth looking at this, right? It's worth it. Why spend your time doing anything else, really? If this is all true, but why spend your time doing something else? This is important. It's important to look at this stuff, right? Okay. Very great. This has been a wonderful video. And as always, We'll see what takes place next. That's the interesting thing, isn't it? After bringing this to light, what is going to take place next? Stay tuned.